praise the Lord.
How many is looking forward to our rising?
Yes, praise the Lord.
Yes, praise God. I'm looking forward to that day. I had a funeral yesterday, and I told the folks, I said, Paul said, if he doesn't have this hope, we were standing at the graveside. If you don't have the hope that one day the trumpet's going to blow. You see, you may not realize this. As great a man as Paul was, his body's in a grave too. You understand that? Have you ever thought of that? He's buried somewhere in Israel. And one of these days, his grave's going to open. I mean, he's not there. You understand? I said he's buried. I meant the house. 2 Thessalonians chapter 5. This tabernacle of clay. One day those graves are going to open, and our spirit's coming back through, and we're going to arise, and they that remain on this earth will be caught up together in the air, and so shall we ever be with God. Nobody can say amen. Well, it's good to be in church and proclaim such truth, because certainly it is truth. I want to thank all those who contributed this morning in the service. Thank you for a job well done. I don't know whether we did this, but is there anyone here for the first time in our services? Anyone? We just want to let you know that we appreciate you. Anybody for the first time? I'll tell you, as many people are away, probably any visitors that thought they were coming probably left too. Good to have you. God bless you. We have a young lady right here. Thank you, Ron. And let's give her a hand this morning. Hope you come again sometime. Be with us. Praise God. If you have your Bibles this morning, turn with me if you would. First of all, now, you that are running the screens and the computer, I've added one more text. And nobody is to be blamed for that but me. But I want you first of all to turn to 2 Kings. 2 Kings chapter 12. Then I'm going to be going to Nehemiah chapter 4, and then I would like to go into the book of Matthew to chapter 26 and just read a couple verses there. Tonight, I would encourage all that can to be here. There's been a thought on my heart that I've been praying about. Jesus is coming soon. We need to pray for the backsliders. Amen. How many can say amen? Amen? And tonight, I'm going to preach part one of a message on the lament of the backslider. It's a very serious message. And it has to deal with how a backslider feels, how miserable they are, until they get right with God. And how close to the doors of hell they are until they make it right with God. So tonight we're going to be preaching on that subject, part one. I don't know when I'll ever preach part two, but we'll get to it as God so deems. 2 Kings chapter 12, verses 5 through 8. I'll be reading from the King James Version today. Let the priests take it to them, every man of his acquaintance, and let them repair the breaches of the house, wheresoever any breach shall be found. But it was so that in the 23rd year of King Jehoash, the priest had not repaired the breaches of the house. Then King Jehoash called for Jehoiada the priest and the other priests, and said unto them, Why repair ye not the breaches of the house? Now therefore receive no more money of your acquaintance, but deliver it for the breaches of the house. Now let me explain that to you, if I may. In those days, it was done much like it is done now. The money that was gathered in the offerings was brought in to take care of buying the bread, the show bread, all that it took to offer the sacrifices. There probably was some monetary payment made to the priests, and that money was just like it's used today for the administration of the church. But over those years, no money, according to the command of the Lord, was put aside to take care of the breaks in the tabernacle, the breaks in the house of God. And this is what this text deals with. And in verse 8 it says, "And the priest consented to receive no more money of the people, neither to repair the breaches of the house." Now turn over with me to the book of Nehemiah, chapter 4. Now, these two texts deal with, if you might say, the literal, the tangible work of repairing the breach. Nehemiah chapter 4 and verse 7. Instead of the tabernacle being repaired, you remember this text. I've preached on it a couple times in the last 6 months. Nehemiah was interested in repairing the walls of the city of Jerusalem. And in verse 7 of chapter 4 of Nehemiah, "But it came to pass that when Sanballat and Tobiah and the Arabians and the Ammonites and the Ashdodites heard that the repairing of the walls of Jerusalem were made up or went forward, the breaches began to be stopped, then they were very wroth." You see, ladies and gentlemen, I'm trying to make this clear to you. Let's make it first of all, a tangible sense. If we had a wall around Mount Morris, and they started shelling that wall, holes would be made in that wall, and the more they shelled it, the weaker that wall would become. And eventually, part of the wall at places would fall down. And there would be open places where the enemy could walk through those walls and impregnate the town of Mount Morris. Now, I know that's tough for you to envision. We don't even have a town council. But just try to envision it, if you can. This is sort of where we are. Let me spiritualize it, if I may. If the enemy continues to come against the walls of the church, or the walls of your house, talking spiritually now, or the walls of your heart, he will cause breaches to come into effect. He will crack the safety barrier wherewith keeps the enemy from impregnating your home, your heart, your home, or your church. Now, if steps aren't taken to repair those breaks, then the enemy will come in and they will trash our church. You say, "Is that possible, Pastor? Is that possible, Pastor?" I don't like to talk about that. That's pessimistic. But all you got to do is read in church news to find out how many church doors are closing every week. Not just in the Assemblies of God, but in every denomination. It's a struggle today to open enough churches to take the place of those who are shutting down. God needs to help us to hear this message. Let's go with me now to the book of Matthew. Now, I've added this, so it's not on the screen, young. And you'll turn in your Bibles, if you will, again reading from the King James Version. I had a reason for sharing this. First of all, it's Communion Sunday, and I like to allude that that's not the real reason why I picked this and added it to the message. Matthew chapter 26, beginning with verse 46. Mark it in your Bible. You talk about a breach. Here's a breach. Here's a spiritual breach, if I ever saw one. Notice what it says, beginning with verse 46. Rise, let us be going. Now you know, just before this portion of Scripture, Jesus and his disciples had been praying in the Garden of Gethsemane. He was sweating great drops of blood. He was preparing himself for the cross. It was a struggle for him. But thank God he didn't back down. He said, fellas, it's time we be going. And so he got his guys together and he said, let's go back. And I think if he was living in today's world, let's get rolling. Let's face the music. Let's get going with what God wants done. How many can say amen?
Amen.
And as he arose and began to go with his disciples, in verse 46 he said, let us be going. Behold, he is at hand that doth betray me. And while he yet spake, lo, Judas, one of the 12, came with him a great multitude with swords and staves from the chief priests and elders of the people. Now he that betrayed him gave them a sign, saying, whomsoever I shall kiss, that same is he, holding fast. And forthwith he came to Jesus, and he said, hail, Master, or hail, Rabbi. The Bible says that he kissed him. Now you know how they do in Israel, or in the Middle East. He took Jesus by the face, and he kissed him on the left side, and then he kissed him on the right side. A lot of people don't realize what this means, but that was by all means a kiss of friendship. How betrayed could a man be than to kiss the man he walked with for 3.5 years on the left side of the cheek? And on the right side of the cheek. Look at the next verse, and then you'll understand why Jesus responded in the way he did. In the next verse it says, and Jesus said unto him, say it with me, friend, do you wonder, or have you ever wondered, why Jesus said that? I know that Judas walked with Jesus all this time. But don't you think that Jesus, in his omniscience, all knowledge, would know ahead of time the heart of Judas? Surely he knew his heart the whole time that Judas walked with him. He knew that he would betray him. He knew that money became his God, and that it was more important to him than his relationship with God, even himself. And this morning, ladies and gentlemen, Jesus responded when Judas kissed him on the left cheek and the right cheek. Jesus said, friend, wherefore art thou come? In various versions of the Bible, it says this, Judas, whatever you have come for, get it done. Get it done. The Bible says that they laid hands on Jesus and they took him. I don't know about you folks, but I think this was an ill-fated time for this breach to occur. Because not many hours, if days later, Jesus was hung on a cross and died, and his disciples were scattered. Peter himself didn't have the guts to tell the people around him that Jesus was his God. But he betrayed Jesus as well, and lied, and then cursed when he was pushed in a corner about his relationship with God. I'll tell you something, folks. If I could just say this in today's terms, and I'm not trying to pull something out of the scripture that isn't there, but I believe that this was a bad time for Jesus, and it was a bad time for his disciples. The 12 disciples was the church that walked with Jesus of that day. And for one of them to make a breach in the relationship that those 12 disciples represented sends a cue to me in this day in which we live. Ladies and gentlemen, we're all still human, and we all still make mistakes. But there's one thing we can ill afford in the church in Mount Morris, is that any such segment of this church would be out of unity with the rest of the church. Because if that happens, certainly there's going to be a break in the wall. There's going to be a breach in the safety barrier. And the enemy is going to walk right through that and bring agony to this body. Mark Twain, among the souvenirs in his memorial in Hartford, Connecticut, one can find these words written on white paper, just a piece of white paper, handwritten and framed. Always do right. It will gratify some people, and it will astonish the rest. How true. You see, ladies and gentlemen, in making reference to Matthew chapter 26 concerning Judas Iscariot and the breach that he caused in the relationship with the disciples and Jesus, something has been said. I think it is so great. There is no better test for a man's ultimate integrity than his behavior when he is wrong. Let me say that one more time. There is no better test for a man's ultimate integrity than his behavior when he is wrong. In my estimation this morning, the church can ill afford a fracture in her fabric, such as is the text concerning the tabernacle. We can ill afford a fracture in our doctrine, in our message, or in the work in which the church does. Israel's enemies counted on the breaches in the walls of Jerusalem not being filled. These would weaken the city's defense and cause it to be unrepaired. You see, the high priest could not rest until he and the king had directed funds toward the repair of the house of the Lord. Let me say this, ladies and gentlemen, this morning as we bear into 4 points as quickly as possible. The church needs to inspect her walls of safety and her foundations. If we allow cracks in the foundation that this church has been built on, then the very foundation of truth in which this church has been built on can be impregnated. I want you to know, in many churches today, there are differences being preached downstairs than there is upstairs. And my Bible tells us to preach true doctrine, and that's something we want in this church. We want to all speak the same thing. We want to all live the same thing. How many can say amen? Amen. It's called holiness. It's called the Word. It's called a stand of righteousness.
Hallelujah.
How we need to do it. Well, Pastor, that church doesn't do it. I'm not responsible for what that church does. I'm not even responsible for what other pastors do in other churches. I'm only responsible for you, and I'm responsible for these men. How many believe that? I'll have to answer to God for my staff, as well as for every family that attends this church. I will answer for it. You see, the church's banners must be sewed and fixed. She cannot afford breaches in house or banner. So let me share with you number one. First of all, the breach speaks to me today, and I hope to you, of broken promises. Go back with me, if you would, to the book of Numbers, chapter 14. I want to read, first of all, verses 1 through 4. And verses 1 through 4 deals with the people's response with respect to broken promises. Notice as I read it, verses 1 through 4. How many, by the way, I won't ask you to raise your hand. This is a rhetorical question. But I've got to say, if you're sitting in this church today and you know anything about God, you more than likely made promises to God, even recently, about your relationship with Him. Let me tell you something, folks. It's a really dangerous thing to make a promise to God and then break it. It's a dangerous thing to do that. Even as small as it may be, you keep your promises to God. I believe there are consequences to have to deal with when we break those promises. Verses 1 through 4, chapter 14 of Numbers. And all the congregation, this is after they crossed the Red Sea and were in the wilderness. And all the congregation lifted up their voice, and they cried, and the people wept that night. And all the children of Israel murmured against Moses and against Aaron. And the whole congregation said unto them, would God that we had died in the land of Egypt, or would God we had died in this wilderness. Wherefore hath the Lord brought us into this land to fall by the sword, that our wives and our children should be a prey? Were it not better for us to return into Egypt? And they said one to another, listen to this. Let us make a captain. Let's get a petition up. Let's get us a captain. Let us go against the leadership. And let's return to Egypt where we came from. I don't know what you see wrong with that, but I see the enemy involved with that. How many can say amen? Now you want to notice what God has to say about this in verses 27 through 34. And you need to mark your Bibles because you need to go home and study this. How long, verse 27, how long shall I bear with this evil congregation, God is saying, which murmur against me? I have heard the murmurings of the children of Israel, which they murmur against me. Say unto them, as truly as I live, saith the Lord, as ye have spoken in my ears, so will I do to you. Boy, this is God speaking. This wasn't Moses. This was God. He used some pretty tough terminology here. Verse 29, your carcasses shall fall in this wilderness, and all that were numbered of you, according to your whole number, from 20 years old and upward, which have murmured against me. Doubtless ye shall not come into the land, concerning which I swear to make you dwell therein, save Caleb the son of Jephunneh, and Joshua the son of Nun. But your little ones, which you said should become prey, them will I bring in. And they shall know the land which you have despised or rejected. But as for you, your carcasses, they shall fall in this wilderness. And your children shall wander in the wilderness 40 years and bear your whoredoms until your carcasses be wasted in this wilderness. Verse 34, after the number of the days in which ye searched the land, even 40 days, each day for a year, shall ye bear your iniquities. Even 40 years
and you shall know my breach, my alienation, if you will, of promise. Somebody said to me not long ago, they said, God never changes his mind, or does he ever break his promises? I want you to know he does. Read that text. Now there's promises that God can't break. His promise of salvation, his promise of redemption, his promise of heaven, his promise of healing. But I want you to know, folks, it's not God that wants to change the course of events. We're the ones in this chapter in verses 1 through 4. It wasn't God who had to change his promise. It was first men who changed their mind. And when that happened, look at verse 34. After the number of the days in which ye searched the land, even 40 days each day for a year shall ye bear your iniquities. Even 40 years. See, God had promised that the generation that went into the wilderness, they would enter into the new promised land. Did he not promise that? He promised that they would go. And then he had to break that promise. Why? Somebody tell me out loud. Because of disobedience. There's yet one more word, three-letter word, I'd like to hear. Because of sin. Somebody, a pastor called me on the phone frustrated the other day. And he said, Pastor, I'm sick of it. I can say, I don't tell you the name. It's not real close here. He said, I'm sick of it. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of it. I'm sick of it. He said, next Sunday morning, I'm going to prepare a message. And I'm going to get in the pulpit and I'm going to clean house. He said, I'm telling you one thing. I'm just going to get rid of everybody and start all over. Now, folks, I told him this. I tried to settle him down. I prayed with him a little bit. He said, Friend, how can you stay so calm? I said, Brother, let me tell you something. It isn't men that clean house. It's God that cleans house. And if we're concerned about rebellion and confusion and disunity, you let God handle it. Because God will change the course in people's lives. Make sure the church goes ahead. How many can say amen? That's a tough statement, but it's the truth. And it could be me. If the pastor stands in the road, he's got a way of removing it.
Right.
So that the church can go forward. Well, say amen. It reminds me of something. Before World War II, Nora Wong wrote a book exposing Hitler and his Nazi plotters. The manuscript, Reaching for the Stars, maybe some of you have read it, it's a great book, was intercepted in the German mails on its way to an American publisher. She fled to London. She rewrote the book from memory and sent copies to Heinrich Himmler, the Nazi hangman. He took vengeance by imprisoning 7 of the author's anti-Nazi friends. Miss Wong came back to Germany in 1939 and offered her life for the freedom of her friends. Himmler offered to empty, listen to this, Himmler, the hangman, offered to empty the whole prison if she would write the book to make Hitler appear good. In refusing, she said, I'm willing to forfeit my life, but not my faith.
Amen.
You see, ladies and gentlemen, God revoked his promise. You put it in your notes. Here's a time when God revoked his promise. God revoked his promise because there was a breach in commitment. You mark that in your black book. A breach in commitment. Which ultimately allowed the Amalekites and the Canaanites to overtake Israel and overrun them. The Bible says, clear to Hormah. Listen to me. Broken promises with God only tend to create even a larger breach in our relationship and our life of victory with the Lord Jesus Christ. Someone has written, it's just in the war cry, and so I wrote it down, but it was an unknown author. God give us men in times like these, and that means women as well. God give us men in times like these with hope and courage strong. Men like Daniel in days of old, who will always stand against wrong. God give us men in times like these with hearts and purpose true, who will stand for right with all their might, despise, and despite of what others do. God give us men who will not swerve from all that's fair and all that's just, with faith in thee through war, peace, a steadfast, perfect trust. God give us men with vision keen, men of integrity, men who will put their hands in thine and then will lead with humility. Number two, not only, I believe, does the breach in this text, spiritualizing that text, by the way, speak of broken promises, but secondly, just bear with me this morning, I believe the breach speaks to us of broken unity and broken respect for authority. In Judges chapter 21 and verse 25, it says, in those days there was no king in Israel. Every man did that which was right in his own eyes. Now let me tell you something right here and right now. If everybody in this church did what was right in their own eyes, there would be a massive chaos. How many understand that? There is no way that any one of us can do what is right in our own eyes. We must do what is right with God's word. If we do otherwise, there will be nothing but chaos. In the book of Romans, boy, what a powerful, you know, Paul was a powerful writer. And you know, from chapter 1, where he talked against homosexuality and against sin, right up through this chapter, I'm going to share with you in chapter 13, verses 1 through 5. I want you to notice, not every soul, that's every church member. Let that sink in a little. Thank you, my sister, from over off of Main Street. Let every church member be subject unto higher powers. For there is no power but of God. Now, I'll tell you the way I used to read this scripture. I used to read this scripture and I misrepresented what that said. I used to think it went like this. For there is no power but God. Is that what that says? It says there is no power but of God. What does that mean? That means that God has placed powers under him. And they must be respected. For there is no power but of God, the powers that are ordained of God. Whosoever therefore resisteth the power, resisteth the ordinance of God. And they that resist shall receive to themselves damnation. Or, in other words, rightly better said, judgment. For rulers, verse 3, are not a terror to good works, but to the evil. Wilt thou then not be afraid of the power? Do that which is good, and thou shalt have praise of the same. For he is the minister of God to thee for good. I got to tell you something. I don't have to mention names, but I'll never forget this. It happened while I've been here. You know, I'm not able to do it as much as I used to, but when somebody's absent from church, I used to be on their doorstep. How many remember that? How many remember if you missed one Sunday, pastor was right there banging on your door? I'll never forget it. Somebody missed church, and then they missed church again. So I let it go for 2 Sundays, and then I went. And they must have read my mind. I went to knock on the door, and there was a sign on the door. said, "Pastor, just wanted you to know why we weren't in church." Oh boy. I never forgot that. I thought that was cute. You know? Where was I? You see, in other words, what I'm trying to get at, don't be afraid of the preacher. Very few people are anyway. But you don't have to be wary of the pastor. The pastor sometimes has to be firm. He has to stand what is best for the congregation, best for all involved. But he's not here to hurt. He's here to help. Anybody understand that? Do you understand that? You sound like you don't agree. But maybe it's just sinking in. But that is the gospel. And so please remember that. Verse 5 says, "Wherefore you must needs be subject, not only for wrath." Don't be subject to your leadership because you're afraid he's going to be on your doorstep. But do it for conscience sake. That involves God.
Yes.
Amen? Amen? You don't owe anything much to me, but you sure owe a lot to God. All of us do. Amen. Okay. Number 3. Before I go to number 3, Abraham Lincoln said something about authority. I wanted to read it. Probably there's been a lot of presidents that have been hated. Loved by one side of, you know, either you belong to one party, you belong to the other. If he's of one party, he's probably fairly loved. The other party, he probably isn't. But Abraham Lincoln was probably hated more by lots of people than any other president I can ever remember. The following 2 statements from Abraham Lincoln tell of his integrity in leading a war-torn nation. Here's what he said. "I desire so to conduct the affairs of this administration that if at the end, when I come to lay down the reins of power, I have lost every other friend on earth, I shall at least have one friend left, and that friend shall live down deep inside of me." How many know him? "I do the very best I know how, the very best I can, and I mean to keep on doing it." How many like that spirit? "I mean to keep on doing it to the end. If the end brings me out all right, what is said against me will not amount to anything. If the end brings me out all wrong, then a legion of angels swearing I was right would make no difference." Amen. You see, usually when there is a breach in God's authority, then there is always mayhem. Number 3, the breach speaks to us of broken relationships. Someone has said integrity without knowledge is weak and useless. How true that is. We can have integrity, but if we don't have enough knowledge to use it, then it's useless and weak. 2 Samuel tells us about it. What a powerful scripture this is. And I'm going to buzz through it. Beginning with verse 1, King James Version. "Again, David gathered together all the chosen men of Israel, 30,000. And David arose and went with all the people that were with him from Baali of Judah to bring up from thence the ark of God, whose name is called by the name of the Lord of hosts that dwelleth between the cherubims. And they set the ark of God upon a new cart and brought it out of the house of Abinadab that was in Gibeon, called the hill, and Uzzah, and Ahio," that's not the Ohio right over here, "and Ahio, the sons of Abinadab, drove," it says in the King James, "drave, but drove the new cart, and they brought it out of the house of Abinadab, which was at Gibeon, accompanying the heart of the ark of God. And Ahio went before the ark. He was ahead, guiding the oxen. He had a hold of the reins, guiding the oxen. Went before the ark, and David and all the house of Israel played before the Lord on all manner of instruments made of fir wood, even on harps and on psalteries and on timbrels and on cornets and on cymbals and on Nashon's threshing floor. Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark of God. This was the other brother, the priest's son. He put his hand. Now, I don't know. I don't want anybody to tell me. I'm going to tell you because we don't have time to wait. But I'll tell you something. This ark represented the holiness of God. How many knows we don't touch God's holiness? He gives his holiness to us. But we don't infringe on his holy guidance. You never tell God what to do. People today are doing it. They get on TV, God forgive me, on radio, and they tell us, if we don't have saturated faith, then we're not a Christian. If we don't have powerful faith, and we're not being healed, then we're not going to church and living for the Lord. I'll tell you something, folks, that's so compromising when it comes to the fact my whole life is built on faith. I don't even know whether I'm going to get this sermon done unless I fall dead in front of you. Yet I have faith. So then if I can speak, I can remove mountains. Cast them into the sea. See, listen to me closely. And when they came to Nashon's threshing floor, Uzzah put forth his hand to the ark of God and took hold of it. Because you see, when the oxen stumbled, it caused the ark to start weaving. And the ark was going to fall over. Well, it was a reflex, I assume. But this young boy reached out his hand and took hold of the ark. What happened when he did that? The Bible says he was struck dead immediately. You know, church, something we need to remember? We need to remember that we just don't dilly-dally around with God. The church needs to remember that. Sometimes our lives are filled with it. And we fool around and dilly-dally around and we place God fifth or sixth down in the capacity of what's most important in our life. Everything else takes first place. That's dilly-dally. That's messing. The Bible says there are consequences to that that will show up either in my life or in the life of my next generation. How many are with me? Is this too strong? David got scared. Not only was he a bit angry. Verse 8, it says that David was displeased because the Lord had made a breach upon Uzzah. And he called the name of the place Perazuzim to this day. And David was afraid of the Lord that day and said, how shall the ark of the Lord come home? I'm not taking this thing back to Jerusalem. I'm afraid to do that. What if this thing starts tumbling again? What are we going to do? Am I going to lose somebody else? Or am I going to be killed? And so he found a home on the way. And David was afraid. So David would not remove the ark of the Lord from that area. And he took David carried it aside into the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite. And the ark of the Lord continued in the house of Obed-Edom, the Gittite, 3 months. And the Lord blessed Obed-Edom and all his household. You say, Pastor, what are you getting at? And I'm going to finish this up. I'll tell you something, folks. You hear me a lot talk about relationships. You hear me say how important it is that people love one another. That people hug one another in services. That people genuinely tell people they care about them. That we retain good relationships with the people around us. Now let me tell you something. If we don't, then it creates a breach. And because of that breach, in the trip with the ark, which represented the presence of God. The presence of God dwelt in a man's home for 3.5 months. And Israel suffered because of it. We can't afford to break relationships. We can't afford to do that. Well, Pastor, you don't know what they've done to me. You don't know what some of them have done to me. But am I quitting? Am I leaving the pulpit? No. Why? Because I don't serve men. I serve God. Number four, and last. Let me reiterate this to you. The breach speaks of broken promises. Secondly, a broken unity, a respect for authority. Thirdly, a broken relationships. And last, I believe this breach in this text speaks to me spiritually of spiritual decay. Next Sunday, by the way, I'm going to preach an uplifting message. So hold your seat. God bless you, okay? We're going to mix this up a little bit. But you know we're living in the last days. You know that, don't you? Got a letter not too long ago, probably the pastors did, about 3 or 4 months ago from the general counsel. They said, preachers, don't quit preaching about heaven. Don't quit preaching about the rapture. How many of you guys got that? Don't quit preaching about that. Because the church needs to hear that Jesus is coming soon.
Amen. Yeah.
Now, if Jesus is coming soon, then I got to remember his words when he said, this is the beginning of sorrows in the book of Matthew. This is the beginning of sorrows. What do we see? We see spiritual decay. We see wickedness in high places. We see all kinds of things happening in our world today. Like, can I tell you this? It's not to bring any, it's no offense to anybody, and it's not because I wanted to be on the news, and I know you'll say, oh, you're a lying preacher. But I was invited when they were over here at Mr. and Mrs. Yost's, and what a great time that was over there, and five different TV stations were there. I was interviewed personally by Channel 11 News, and the question that I was asked was, Pastor Tomlinson, what is your perspective on, does God have anything to do with this? Well, you know, folks, if I get that opening, then I'm going to say it. Right? I just told him, I said, Psalm 139, the writer wrote, where can I go where God's Spirit is not? If I go into the heavens, he is there. If I go to the depths of the sea, he is there. If I would make my bed in the depths of a dark hole, I didn't use hell. I used Sheol. They probably didn't know what that meant. But I said, the Bible says his Spirit is there. And I said, you want my opinion? We do. I said, I believe the Holy Spirit of God walked the aisles of that mind. And I said, I'll leave one more with you, part two. I said, all this in 20 seconds. How many believe I could do that? I said, Psalm 91 says that he has commissioned angels to watch over us, lest we stumble or fall. And they hold us up. And I said, I also believe that angels were present.
Amen.
Not because of the men necessarily, as much as for the prayer. How many can say amen?
Amen.
Well, needless to say, none of you saw my ugly mug on TV. they didn't put that on. But I know that I got to testify to almost 300 people there. So I thank the Lord for that. And we give God glory for those miracles. Don't we, folks? We give God glory. Let me tell you, there is a breakdown in these last days. Men are getting glory for what God ought to get glory for. We need to refurbish the church with attention to the Almighty. That says, Isaiah 30, verse 26. I'm doing this in closing. Moreover, the light of the moon shall be as light as the sun. And the light of the sun shall be sevenfold as the light of 7 days. In the days that the Lord bindeth up the breach of his people. Did you hear that? Bindeth up the breach of his people. And healeth the stroke of the wound. I'm not going to read all the verses in chapter 60, but I'd like you to write them down. Isaiah chapter 60. They'll be on the screen, some of them. Verses 10 through 21. But in these references, it speaks about how Israel, she could have followed God and kept the covenant and kept the requirements of the covenant. But because she didn't, entrance was made in chapter 60. You read it. Entrance was made by the Gentiles. And they were grafted in. It doesn't say that, but it alludes to that. And if you follow through in your concordance, you will find that to be true. What does that say to me and you? It says whether it's Israel or whether it's a church today, which Israel is a type of the church, that if we allow spiritual decay to overtake us, what a wonderful service we had this morning. What a wonderful service. But I'm going to leave you with this. Maybe I'll get fired for this. If we leave this church as church members here, and we go out and dabble in the world, and we do worldly practices, how can we expect God to bring victory? It does nothing but bring a breach into the continuity of the Holy Spirit. And when God would want to do something, he's got to tramp across our deliberate sin to get through what he wants to do. Pardon me for pulling my pants. Do you understand what I'm trying to say? Someone told me not long ago, said, Pastor, you're too old-fashioned. Too old-fashioned. You ought to loosen up a little bit. I'll tell you, folks, I still have convictions. I still believe there are rights and there are wrongs. And as long as I got breath in this old carcass of mine, I'm going to do my best to live. I believe if that happens, and we do our work in this church to mend up the breaches, the cracks, the breaks, and that old devil will not be able to walk into this church anymore and afflict our people. Say, Pastor, how can that be? If it was good for Israel, it's good for us. In the 12th chapter of Exodus. And I close with this. It's not up there, so don't look for it. In the 12th chapter of Exodus, it refers not only to the blood being applied to the doorposts and the firstborn being protected from the death angel, but there's a statement made about Israel. It says that the Egyptians were sore unto death from the botch. How many of you remember reading that? That's in the King James Version. It'll probably say boils, or it'll say infection in some of the other versions. But in the King James Version, it says they were dying like flies, the Egyptians, from the botch. Sores that big over the door. Guess what it said about Israel? Not one Israeli ever. Now listen. While they were in bondage in Egypt, got sick. Not one. What does that speak to you? It speaks that there is a protection from God. And I believe the church can enjoy that to an extent. How many can say, I know there are sicknesses and things that all of us have to face. There is disease all around the world now that is just thick. But I believe that God can protect his people. Do you still believe that? You old-fashioned. Do you believe that God can still protect his people? Him can protect our family, still protect our kids, still protect our relatives, still protect our church, still protect this community. The devil has no right to Mount Morris. That's why this church is here. And I pray before Almighty God, as long as this church is sitting on this little hill, that the enemy will fear walking into Mount Morris. What is it? It's going to take mending the bridges. It's going to take fortifying the walls and saying nothing that is ungodly is allowed to penetrate. We will be safe by the hand of God. Stand with me. Holy Spirit spoke to me this morning, coming back from the hospital. As I was praying, I said, Lord, what should I do? People get tired of all this. They hear the same old thing over and over again. What about this? What about that? What about the other thing? Pretty soon we exhaust maybe some of those needs. People don't have any reason to come. This morning, the Lord seemed to speak to my heart and said, ask one thing. Just ask your people. If there's just one little thing, one little thing that is starting to make a fracture in your walls. Because what starts cracking will eventually break down. How many understand that? It will eventually break down. Ask your people, Fred, is there even one little thing that I've got to deal with and get under the blood? If there is, then let them obey me. So this morning I'm simply saying this. If there's even one little thing in your life, your home, your job, your individual heart, that is allowing the take your mind away from God and from victory. Why don't you just, in the closing prayer this morning, lay it at the altar. Just come and stand and say, God, I'm going to drop it right here and I'm not taking it home with me. I'm going to leave it right here. I don't want to leave this church unsaved. If I haven't been forgiven of my sins, I'm not leaving this church. Don't get saved. I can't save you. I wish I could. If I could, I would have poured it into you by now. But I can't do it. Only God can. But if you're ready to do whatever you have to do to make your home a godly home, to make this church a godly church, to make our community a community that will hear the message this church has to give them, I want you to come. Lay that thing here. Anybody. Just gotta wait a moment. Just a moment. Won't be laboring. Take a hand to somebody next to you, ladies. I don't want to be known as a pessimistic preacher. But I do know this, that sometimes the Word of God is sharp. The Bible says it cuts even to the marrow and the bone, soul and spirit. Sometimes it hurts. I'd rather be hurt, wouldn't you? And have a chance to get something straightened up. And not hear the truth. So this morning, just join me as we make this prayer, as folks are talking to God on this altar right now. Heavenly Father, if I have sinned, forgive me in any way, in word or in deed or in thought. Forgive me. If there's anything that I do that contributes to a fracture or a breach in my family, my home, or my church, forgive me. If my example in this town has been relinquished, forgive me. And God, I ask you that your Holy Spirit would renew a spirit of wisdom and knowledge within my heart, so that I might be a pastor of integrity. Might be able to reach this town for Jesus Christ, the lowest of the low. I might be able to share the gospel with them and see them saved. The richest of the rich, I might be able to see the gospel touch their lives. Those who are depressed, those who are heavy laden, those who don't know what to do tomorrow, in the name of Jesus Christ, may what you do for me, you do for them. And may these people around this altar this morning ask you for guidance in what they need to do to get out of the trial, get out the concrete, the cement, get out the blocks. I'm going to rebuild the breaches. I'm going to close the chasms. The enemy is not going to freely walk into my life ever again. We ask you to do that right now. Through your blood, through your redemption, through the Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. God bless you. Jesus Christ is Lord. Would you sing it with me? God bless you. I'm going to stay at the altar for a few moments. May God bless you.